strapping muscled man, but I would you could see him then. That father grabbed that girl up in his arms and you just feel tears all over. How he cried out loud, my Betty, they had her everywhere. Medical science couldn't do anything for her, but in a fraction of a second, God healed that precious little girl. Then my brother-in-law took her up in his arms and how he wept over that little girl. He's known her all her life. Listen, they didn't put her back in a public or in a deaf and dumb school. That little girl was put in a public school. She finished She finished high school. She finished nurse's training. 3 years ago, I went to her wedding. She married a young doctor, an intern in the hospital. Talk about a beautiful wedding. Oh, but every member of that family has the baptism of the Holy Ghost. They've been buried in the lovely name of Jesus in water baptism. All right, what about my family? My sister, babe, has the baptism of the Holy Ghost. She's been buried in the lovely name of Jesus in water baptism. Not one member of my family, this media family, ever went back in the Roman Catholic Church again. Her husband, she went to the altar. Oh, yes. Now, that little bitty kid, a two-and-a-half-year-old, that 16-year-old girl is married and has 5 children. She and her husband and the 3 oldest children are all saved and filled with the Holy Ghost and been baptized in the lovely name of Jesus. And this little Patty, my sister's smallest child, she just recently, about a year ago, I was privileged to see her. She, too, is an RN, and she married a young intern. And they're living in Boston, Massachusetts right now. Oh, but they both had the baptism of the Holy Ghost. Folks, it's perfectly wonderful what God is doing for my people now. I'm willing to be the sacrifice down through those ages, but it's wonderful what God is doing. Oh, how wonderful it is. All right, this is all very beautiful. But I tell you right now, when I see all of these, all Roman Catholic people, don't forget that God loves the Roman Catholic people and he's saving them all over the country right now. All right, now, so after a period of time, Sister Nyla and I were going to go to the West Coast. I wrote a letter to my father and I told him I'm coming to the West Coast. Oh, no. Yes. Do you know how I found out my father was not dead? I went back to the revival where I left Sister Nyla. I told Baden and Carl, I said, now I have to go, honey. I'm going back to the revival. God performed a miracle, and now they heard the gospel because I gave them plenty of it, bought them Bibles, and so on and so forth. But I have to go back. And you know, folks, I told them goodbye, but I'm coming back to see you. I told them. All right, I'd been exactly 5 days in that revival meeting, and here comes a telegram from Babe, the one God healed. And she said, Charlotte, your father is here. Will you come home? I thought my father was dead. I sent a wreath of flowers to his funeral. You know what they done? Oh, what they won't do. I think they put me through everything they put me through. I live in a small rural community, and they wanted to get me back in a convent. And that priest was rack of the whole thing, that old father confessor. And he was. They informed me that my father was dead and when the funeral was going to be, but he wasn't dead. They thought I would come back to that small rural community, and they'd crowd me back into a hospital again. That's what they were after all the time. That's why my father and those two priests come to take me home. If they ever got me in that car, they put me back in the hospital. Thank God I didn't go. I didn't trust them, so I didn't go. And I didn't know Dad. All right, I said, now I have to go again. I left her still in that same revival. Went on for 13 weeks. All right, I went back to my sister's home. And you know, I haven't seen my father for quite some time. And he's 81 years of age, and he's not very well. And you know, my father is a very independent man because he has too much. And he don't ask favors of anybody. And I know him well enough to know how his disposition. And so when I walked in the living room where he was, well, he just looked at me and he said, well, Hookie, you look wonderful. That's my pet name. And I walked over to my father and he held his arms out. He embraced me, asked me to forgive him. And he said, I'm going to leave in the morning. I'm going to the West Coast to see my brother, the priest, and those two sisters. And, oh, my, he said, if you'll address some envelopes, I'll write to you. I've never received a letter from my dad. I addressed the envelopes and took my father to the train the next morning. He went to the West Coast, you know, and he was out here 6 weeks. And he wrote to me all the time. He'd come home, let me know when he got home. And when I got his letter, I wrote him a letter and said, Dad, Nyla and I are going to the West Coast 22 years ago. We're coming out here to preach the gospel for a year on the West Coast. And oh, my father said, would you please come by? Of course, I want to win my dad. And drove out of our way, but we went by my father's. And I couldn't touch him. You couldn't say one word about the Lord or anything. He didn't want to hear anything. All right. I couldn't reach him at all. But anyway, we stayed overnight with him, and he was rather nice, and he set his Nyla nicely and so on and so forth. And so we went to the West Coast. We got out to the West Coast. Brother William Smith, he had a church in Los Angeles. That's the first revival we held. He's in that revival for 2 weeks. And on the second Sunday, I said, Nyla, you and Brother and Sister Smith go to church. I'm not going this morning on Sunday morning. I'm going in that bedroom. I'm going to get on my face. I'm going to stay right there until God gives me the grace and the courage to get up and go to that telephone and call my brother. And I tell you, 11:30, I get off of my knees. I went to the telephone. I call my brother, the priest. He don't recognize my voice. I didn't recognize him. But when I told him who he was, he broke down and began to cry. And he said, Charlotte, where are you? Can I come to you? I said, oh, no, Chet. He said, oh, Charlotte, would you forgive me? Why did I hit you? You know why I hit you? It's the devil in him. That's what makes you do such ungodly things. The devil in you. All right. I said, no, Chet, you can't come to me. But the little girl that travels with me, as soon as she gets home from church, we're coming to see you, Chet. And he was the happiest person in the world. Again, he asked me to forgive him. Again, he told me how sorry he was. He said, I don't know why I done it. I shouldn't have done it. I'm sorry, and I'm not. All right. But he gave me an address. I knew that was not the address of his church and home, and I know something's wrong. But see, I don't ask a lot of questions. When you're dealing with Roman Catholic people, ask God for wisdom, because you'll drive them from you instead of helping you. You just have to use all the wisdom God can give you and plenty of psychology along with it. All right, so I'm very cautious and very careful. But I knew he gave me the wrong, strange address. And I asked him, is this the address you want me to come to? He said, yes. All right, so Sister Nyla and I was sitting on how to come home from church, and Brother Sister's bed. We didn't eat any after food that day. They went on their knees, and they're going to pray while Nyla and I drive across the city of L.A. to my brother, where my brother told me to come. And it was 12 miles through that city. Oh, folk, I called him 5 minutes before I got there. And you know what? When I drove up in front of this house, there he was. He had on a khaki, a pair of trousers, and a sweatshirt. He was standing out on the front steps of that home. And the moment I pulled the car up there, he was down there like a flash. He had the door open. He had me in his arms, and he was crying like a little boy. And he just kept saying, have you forgiven me? Have you forgiven me? And I said, yes, Chad. And then I introduced him to Sister Nyla. He had never met her. He was very nice to her. And then he said, you're going to come in, aren't you? And I said, yes, for a little bit. But yet, we both have to speak tonight. We have a long ways to drive. All right, we got out of the car, and we walked up on the front porch, and we stepped inside. It was a beautiful big living room. And right there were two chairs, and he invited us to sit down there. Well, now I'll sit down. And I guess I'm a little slow. I want to be sure I want to look everything over before I sat down. And I sat down slowly, and as I did, I saw over here a beautiful girl sitting over there, a very young girl, but very beautiful. And I swept over, then I sat down. And when I sat down, then my brother turned around and motioned for this girl over here to come over where we were. And folks, he brought that girl over there, and he introduced that lovely girl to us. And she was, I think, the prettiest woman I've ever seen in my life. When he introduced that woman to us, he introduced her as his wife. My brother had left the priesthood, taken off his holy habit, and this is his wife. I nearly died. I fell. I almost had a heart attack. I didn't know any of this is transpired. I've been praying for him. I didn't know what had happened. Not a thing about it. And you know, I immediately said, Chet, we have to go. I just wanted to get out of there. I didn't know what it was all about. And so we went out to the car. He followed us. She went back over and sat down. And we went out to the car. I was driving, and I left the car door open. He's standing out there by me. I said, Chet, tell me what this is all about. Just tell me what in the world has happened. He said, you just give me 5 minutes, and I can tell you. And this is what he told me. He said, Charlotte, one day I went down in Hollywood, and there I was in a secondhand bookstore. You know, I told you we're all readers. And he said, I was browsing through that bookstore, and I run onto a very old version of the King James Version of the Bible. And Chet said, I have 3 Bibles I preach out of, but I liked that Bible and had some things in it I didn't know and had never read. And so he bought that Bible for a quarter. And he took that Bible home and began to make a study of that Bible. And this girl come to his home and be his housekeeper, that beautiful young girl, 20 years of age. And my brother took that girl to his home, and she was his housekeeper for 7 long years. But 7 long years they lived in adultery. 7 long years they lived as man and wife, and they were not married. All that holy habit they wear covers up a lot that you don't know anything about. And you know, my brother then become, he's still reading and studying this Bible, and something got a hold of him, and he said to this girl, I'm going to notify the Pope I'm leaving the priesthood. And she said, if you leave the priesthood, are you leaving the Roman Church? And he said, I'm getting out of the whole thing. And she said, if you go, I'm going. All right, my brother. And this is what happened. He said he wrote to the Pope, and the Pope sent the letter to the bishop of that diocese over my brother, and the bishop met my brother, and they were going to transfer him to South America. And he said, you're not transferring me anywhere. I'm taking the holy habit off. I'm leaving the priesthood. I'm leaving the Roman Catholic Church. Oh, they tried everything. I tell you right now, they just they tormented him to death. And so he and the girl come out, and they were married in about 6 months after he went out of the priesthood. Well, then, after that, of course, she told me all of this story. Then I was privileged. She wanted me to go and see these two sisters. I didn't want to go. But all I went to see these two sisters, and they didn't treat me very nicely. He made the appointment. I didn't. Their names are Tony and Bess. And, you know, I went to see them, and, of course, they have so much money. And they have gorgeous homes, and they have everything money can buy. And I don't feel at all at home in their house, I can assure you. And I know they don't want any part of me, as far as that's concerned. All right, but I went with my brother because I didn't want to hurt him. And he knew, they knew we were coming. And when we got there, we got out of the car and walked there. They were standing out in the car. They had their stoles, their gloves, and their hats on. They were going someplace. In other words, they just didn't want us to come in. And it hurt me very deeply. And so we stood out in the yard and talked a little bit. And my brother said, "Mom, your flowers are beautiful." And then he made this statement, "Isn't God wonderful?" And I took it up. I'm only a baby in the Lord, and I didn't have any wisdom then. And I took it up, and I began to tell a few things about God and how wonderful He is, and on and on. And, oh, Toddy, the younger one, they're both younger than I. She just walked, I think she's the most beautiful woman. She looks like my mother. And, of course, she's in a beauty salon every week, and she wouldn't eat one ounce of anything that would put about a pound of flesh on her. She's perfect weight. All right, and, of course, she dresses so gorgeously and all of that. And, you know, she just walks up to me and puts her hands against my chest and pushes me completely back. And she said, "Let's get this straight. I'm a Roman Catholic, I'll die a Roman Catholic, and I don't want anything you have." And she made it plain. "But you can't stop me from praying. I don't care what you say. I'm going to pray for you anyway." And my bestie was ugly. She just walked away. Listen, folks. Sister Nana and I worked for 1 year on the West Coast, went back to Texas. We worked then 18 months, 6 months in the West, in Texas. And then one day a letter come from the West, from the West Coast here, from my oldest sister, Beth. She said, "If you folks know how to pray, you better pray for Toddy. Toddy has just come out of surgery, and the doctor that operated on her, she had a double inward goiter, and he removed that goiter, and he severed her vocal cords, and she can't talk, and she'll never talk again." Well, it was a terrible thing, but it was a mistake, of course. And, oh, it was pitiful. All right, 2 days exactly after that operation, Toddy went stone blind in both eyes. And more than that, 6 weeks after that operation, she was still in the hospital. And my sister is a trained dancer, and she has two lovely daughters, and they're both trained dancers, and they'd rather dance than eat the best meal that's ever cooked. And you know, in about 6 weeks, arthritis struck her, and it twisted those beautiful hands that I looked at, and those beautiful feet, it just twisted them all out of shape. No, she's not going to dance. She don't see, she doesn't talk, and she can't walk. I don't know how much worse you can be. I had already bought her 2 Bibles and she burned them. I have did everything that I'm big enough to do to help that girl. Both of the girls, they paid no attention. All right, it went on and on and on. And we just, the churches back home were praying and praying, and some were fasting. But you know, it went right on. And finally, Toddy had my sister write a letter and said, "If God will let me walk, if you let me talk, if you let me sing, I'll buy a Bible and I'll read it and I'll go to church." She only lied. She didn't mean a word of it. All right, you know, and the day come when my sister, the arthritis began to clear up and she could walk. And then there was an opera singer on the West Coast. An older woman retired, and she come to their home, and she was teaching my sister to speak from the diaphragm from way down here. And about a year and a half before she could get her to talk. And my sister got so she could speak in a bass voice, but very low. You have to be close to hear. Now, my sister can walk, and my sister can talk. Do you think she went to church? Not on your life. She went right on serving her cocktail parties, right on playing bingo, everything she's big enough to do. All right. It went on, and then my brother-in-law took her all over the country for her eyes. Nobody would operate on her. One day then a doctor moved over to L.A. from old Mexico, and she heard about him, two friends, and they took her down there, and this doctor said, "I believe you'll see if you let me operate." And they operated on my sister, one eye. And you know, my sister, a few weeks after the operation, the doctor was dressing that eye, and she looked right up in that doctor's face and said, "Doctor, I didn't know you wore glasses." She could see beautifully out of that eye. 8 months they operated on the other eye. She sees beautifully. You think she went to church? No, she lied to God. Oh, listen, you just keep right on lying to God, some of you. I said, "Right, you keep right on shutting the door in God's face, and one of these days God's going to permit you to be stretched out there on your back, and you're not going to walk anymore. You're going to have plenty of time to lay there and look at the four walls. You shut the door in God's face. You know the way. You've heard the truth, but you don't want any truth. Just keep right on, but God's not going to always strive with you. Don't forget it." All right, a year and a half after that, then the letter come, or the long-distance call come, and what happened? Toddy wakened her husband up one morning and said, "Gus, I have a severe pain right under my short rib." And he got her up and she got worse. And then he called the hospital and they took her to the hospital. And there they kept her for 5 days and they run tests on her. And of course it was malignancy operation. They removed 24 inches of the large intestine. It was malignancy.
She got up out of that hospital. She went home. 2 years my sister was in that home. And my, she enjoyed the beauties of that home. Got along beautifully. Did she go to church? No. She still lied to God. She didn't do one thing she promised God she'd do. All right, now 2 years went by here, over here. And now my brother-in-law rushed her right into the hospital. They run a 2-day test. And he called my brother-in-law and said, come and get her. She's cancer all over her body. We can't operate. She never got out of the hospital. She laid right there, and with her two daughters who are married, one has 3 children, the other two, with them and their husband standing there, and her husband standing there, she went out into eternity screaming, I'm afraid, I'm afraid, I'm afraid. Why wouldn't she be afraid?